God. When I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Now great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. When I think that God is Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me. Now great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou great thou art. How great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great you are. My soul, my Savior God, to thee. Thou great thou art. How great you are. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art. How great you are. How great you are. How great you Lord, how great you are, how great. Great you are. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless you. You are incredible, God. You are amazing, Lord. We honor you. We honor you with this song. These words ring true and will ring true throughout all of eternity, Lord. Hallelujah. We bless you. We bless you. Lord, receive this sacrifice of praise, this offering of worship, Lord, that we give to you. We bless you, Lord. Father, we ask that you would bless this word that you've put within my heart, Lord, that it would minister to your people in Jesus' mighty name. Everyone. All right. Hallelujah. Feel a peace. Feel a peace of God. I like peace. Don't you like peace? I remember when I found peace. When I finally let him in to every area of my life, every area of my mind, every area, that's kind of hard to say, it's like a tongue twister right there, every area of my heart, man, that peace came in that transcends all understanding. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for peace. In this world, you'll have tribulation, but you'll have my peace, says the Lord. It's a good word. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn with me tonight to Deuteronomy chapter 8. And we'll read beginning in verse 1. We'll probably make it down to about verse 3. Deuteronomy chapter 8. Verse 1 reads, every commandment which I command you today, you must be careful to observe, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land of which the Lord swore to your fathers. This is very reminiscent of the passage of scripture that we read this past Sunday in Joshua chapter 1, and this passage of scripture here in Deuteronomy, it precedes Joshua chapter 1. Moses is instructing the Israelites as they were going to go into the promised land. He would not be going himself, but Joshua would lead him. And so he says, every commandment which I command you today, you must be careful to observe, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land. That word possess, it means to seize. It means to occupy. These are military terms that God had spoken to Moses to go in and to take the land. He said, but you got to be careful to observe everything that I've commanded you, that you may live. And God's commandments bring life to us. It benefits you to obey God's word. He didn't give his word to throw a towel over a blanket over fun, but it actually brings life. And if you'll listen to people when they share their testimonies, when they turn to the Lord, all of a sudden they found joy, they found peace, they found happiness. I think it's Psalms 119 says, you know, blessed are those who have integrity, who walk in integrity. You know, there is a joy and happiness that comes when we do what is right in the eyes of the Lord. And it says here, and you shall remember that the Lord your God. You know, it is so important to write down your journey that you have with God. You know, sometimes we look back after a week or after a month. Well, I don't see a whole lot of change. Well, you got to give it some time. Give the Lord some time to work on you. Look back in a year and then kind of evaluate and see. And you'll see you've grown so much. And so I would encourage you guys to journal your journey, your experiences with God, to remember what he's done. As a matter of fact, God instructed the Israelites and Joshua to set up a memorial everywhere they went. Abraham, everywhere he went, he would set up an altar. He would set up a memorial to the Lord to remember what God had done for them. And do the same yourself. And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness. I imagine when he said these words, 40 years, it's kind of like a knife, like, oh yeah, remembering a 3-day journey turned into 40 unnecessary years because they complained. They walked in unbelief. They murmured. Instead of reacting in faith, they chose to complain. I mean, Moses, there weren't enough graves in Egypt. You had to bring us out here to Egypt, outside of Egypt in the wilderness to die. And the Lord was looking for the Israelites to have faith. You know, I could just see the Lord. Didn't I deliver you from the hand of Pharaoh with all those plagues that I personally did? Don't you remember the Red Sea? Don't you remember the manna? The quail, and yet every time they would complain, they would murmur, they would walk in unbelief instead of exercising their faith. And so he says, and you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way, these 40 years in the wilderness, look at this, to humble you and test you. You know, God will humble us if we aren't obedient, if we're walking in rebellion to his word. A few years back, my family and I, we went on vacation to Singapore. Now, Danielle and I, in our early years on the mission field, when we went to Singapore and Malaysia, I mean, we weren't poor, we were po. I mean, we bought a chicken at the beginning of the week. What do you call it, rotisserie chicken? And we would break that up, and we would eat on that all week with bread. I mean, that was like our meals for lunch. You know, we were poor, but hey, we were right in the middle of God's will, so it was awesome. But years later, we got to go back to Singapore with some money. Someone had blessed us with money for a vacation where we didn't have to worry about anything for a week. I mean, we went to Singapore. We rode around in taxis the whole time. You know how much that cost? A lot. We went to restaurants, and we went to the aquarium. We went to the zoo. And on the day that we went to the zoo, was that our anniversary? It was that day our anniversary. That day. And I you know, I'm normally in a good mood, you know. I'm nice. But that particular day, I got up on the wrong side of the bed for whatever reason. So I was grumpy, you know. I was like a bear that had been poked. And so I was kind of quiet, not really wanting to talk about anything. And I got we had to take a bus to go to the zoo. And so we get there, we get into the zoo, and we had breakfast with the orangutans. And it was amazing. You know, I got my breakfast, and we sat down. The kids are sitting across from me. There was a couple, I don't remember where they were from, but I began to engage in a conversation with them, and finally, you know, I started eating my breakfast, and as I'm eating my breakfast, something happened. It was like a Chili's moment, Mr. Johnny, where all of a sudden, my food went down the wrong channel, and I choked, and I coughed, and just spit all over the table. I mean, egg was on my kids' faces. It was, I mean, I was humiliated. Needless to say, I did not look at the couple after that. I'm like, you know, eat my food. They didn't look at me either. They didn't want any projectile, you know, coming at them like a missile. She said, Samuel said, Dad, you got egg on my hair. But needless to say, I was humiliated in that moment. And you know what? When God humbles you, it means he'll humiliate you. The Bible says to humble yourself and God will lift you up. So our job is to humble ourselves and God will lift us up. But if we lift ourselves up, God will make sure and do our job and humble us. And that's what he did with the Israelites. And it says here that he to humble you and to test you. Do you know that the Lord will test you? To see whether you obey him or not. Jesus tested his disciples. He would preach a message like, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you can have no part of me. The Bible says that the multitudes, even the 72 disciples, because Jesus had more than just the 12, he had the 72 as well, they walked away from him. And if you'll notice in Scripture, Jesus didn't say, oh, wait, hey, guys, I'm just talking about communion. He let them go. It was a test to reveal what was in their heart. And the Lord will give leadership. He'll give a pastor authority. And at times there's testing as well, where a pastor will test people to see where they're at. This isn't going over so well. I've had times where I've gone to my mentors and I just sat down with them and I've asked them, is there anything in my life that you see? Because you're my authority. God's placed you over me. He's given you perspective. You can see things in my life that I can't see and I need help. And it was some of the best thing that ever happened to me because I had insight into things that I just could not see. Amen to that. It says, so he humbled you, allowed you to hunger, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. So the lesson of the manna there every day, 6 days a week, and the Israelites having to go out and collect it, was that man cannot live by food alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Our spiritual survival is dependent upon hearing the voice of God through his word. And you know, I don't want to just spiritually survive. I want to be alive in God. And so there's this invitation to come and feast on his word. Last week, towards the end of my message on Wednesday, I shared that a lot of times people are looking for change to come from the outside. You know, someone will respond to an altar call, and they're hoping that lightning will strike them, and they'll get up off the floor, and they'll just be forever changed. Now, powerful things can happen in an altar call, but you have the responsibility of partnering with God's word to see change take place. A lot of people are anointed, but they're not walking, their character isn't up to the level of their anointing, and God, he's looking for us to grow in character. He wants truth on the inside of us, righteousness on the inside of us. And so change, transformation really takes place on the inside. The Bible says in Romans 12, verse 1, or it might be verse 2, where transformation takes place through the renewing of our mind. Amen? The Bible says in Genesis chapter 8, verse 22, that while the earth remains, would you say that the earth is remaining? All right. Seed time and harvest, cold and heat, winter and summer, and day and night shall not cease. I want to highlight this. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest shall not cease. The way that this world operates is through a seed. A seed is very powerful. You look at all of plant life. You look at the animal kingdom. You look at humans. The way we reproduce and bear fruit, if you will, is through a seed. You know, no one can really create a seed just like God has created a seed. It doesn't have that life in it. I mean, it may look like it. It may kind of taste like it. But it doesn't, because that seed, a real seed, is supernatural. God created it. And it is powerful. You know, there was only one virgin birth. That's Mary. There is no woman on planet Earth that can pray enough to have a baby outside of having a relationship with a man. She has to have that seed in her in order to have a baby. There are a lot of Christians that are praying for things, but they don't have a seed, a promise from God's word that is in their heart that they're holding on to. And I would ask you, whatever you're praying for, what's the address of that scripture? Is it even legal? I mean, if you're praying for your mother-in-law to die, you're not going to find a verse on that. You got to have verse. You got to have a scripture. What about healing? If you're believing for healing, what scripture are you holding on to? There are so many. But in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, it says, "But he who was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." You got to take that seed and put that in your heart and begin to meditate and hold on to God's promise and believe. Just like the woman with the issue of blood. Now, I don't know if she had a verse for that, but the Bible says she kept saying to herself over and over, "If I could just touch the hem of his garment, if I could just touch God." The Bible says, "If you seek me, you will find me. If I could just touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole." She kept saying that to herself over and over and over until she touched him and got what she desired. Some people, they don't when they're sick, they won't even ask the pastor or the elders to pray for them. Why not? The Bible says this in James chapter 5, verses 14. "Is anyone among you sick?" And if you don't have enough faith, if your faith isn't there at the level yet where you can receive healing by yourself, you may need to do this. "Is anyone sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up." What about in the business sector? You're desiring a business, something that you can do. You have a verse for that? The Bible says this in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18, "And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth." Whew. That's Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 18. It says that he may establish his covenant which he swore to your fathers as it is this day. God wants you to have wealth to establish his covenant. He is all about covenant. And when you're walking in the blessing of God, oh, that's someone that's in covenant with Almighty God. You're a sign and a wonder for the world to look at and to be envious. Man, I want what he's got. That's what the Lord did with the Israelites. He blessed them that they would be the envy of the world. Well, what God do you serve? I serve the Almighty God, the Alpha and the Omega. Come on. What about a scripture for encountering the Lord? Man, I want to encounter God. Do you have a verse for that? The Bible says in Jeremiah 29, verse 11, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you." And look at this, verse 13. "And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. I will be found by you, says the Lord." Seek, and you will seek me and find me. You know, we talk about seeking the Lord. I say, you know, I'm seeking God, but I'm not trying to find him. Like, I have already found God. So when I say I'm seeking the Lord, I really mean that I'm just spending time with him. How many of you know that we should find God? I mean, some people, they spend their whole life searching for God, and it's like they never really find him. They never really encounter him. But he says, if you seek me, you will find me. We should find God. And when you have him, don't let him go. He promised to never leave us and never forsake us. He's with us. Isn't this good? But he says, when you search for me with all your heart, that's the key. Well, you know, I don't have a whole lot of time. I got my business. I got my kids. They're in Little League. And, you know, we just don't have a whole lot of time for the Lord. Well, if you don't make time for God and make him a priority, well, you'll just have a little bit. You can have as much or as little of God as you want. He's a gentleman. What about if things aren't working out? Things are going haywire at work or at home. Things are messed up with your kids. You have scripture and verse. Romans 8, 28 says, "And we know that all things work together. All things work together for good to those who love God." What about desiring the baptism of the Holy Spirit? I want the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Do you have a verse for that? Do you have something to put in your heart? How about Luke chapter 11 and verse 13? "If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Ask and you shall receive. The Bible says you have not because you ask not. Ask the Lord for the Holy Spirit. And when you have Holy Spirit, you have him. He's not going anywhere. Enjoy fellowship with him. Spend time with him. Acknowledge his presence. Become aware of him. When you get in the car and you're by yourself, "Hello, Holy Spirit. It's just you and me and you." Spend time with him. Talk to Holy Spirit. He wants to talk to you. He's got a lot to say. Everything that Jesus said, he'll remind you of what he said. And it'll bring life to you. Amen? So there's this principle. And I shared it last week. It's found in Mark chapter 6 and verse 26, where Jesus said, "God's kingdom realm is like someone spreading seed on the ground. He goes to bed and gets up day after day, and the seed sprouts and grows tall, though he knows not how." You don't know how that happens. Verse 28, "All by itself it sprouts, and the soil produces a crop. First the green stem, then the head on the stalk, and then the fully developed grain in the head. Then, when the grain is ripe, he immediately puts the sickle to the grain, because harvest time has come." So the seed represents the word of God. The ground represents your heart. If you don't put that seed in the ground, it will not benefit you. If you told me you had 1,000 bags of corn seed in a bag, but you didn't put it in the ground, it won't benefit you at all. You could have 20 Bibles at home. You could have 100 Bible versions on your phone. You can have 1,000 scriptures memorized in your mind, but it won't benefit you unless you put it in your heart. It is meditating upon God's word that brings transformation. If your time, your devotion time is 10 minutes of someone reading the Bible to you in the morning, and that's it. The word of God is not really going to work for you. Remember, he told Joshua to meditate upon the law, meditate upon his word day and night. Day and night. If you're meditating on the news all the time, well, guess what's going to come out? The news, all the negativity. But if you're feasting on God's word, as soon as you hear a negative report, all of a sudden, God's word is going to act as a shield. Well, I'm a child of God. That's not going to have any effect on me. I don't care what the president says. I'm going to walk in the blessing of God. I'm not going to walk in fear. I'm not going to walk in unbelief. Just because there's a certain administration in office doesn't mean that God's word won't work for me. Put it in your heart. And this takes time. I mean, it says here, he goes to bed and gets up day after day. Day after day. Mr. Johnny, you just recently planted some corn. Is that right? Did you plant it and then the next day you went out there and you just looked at that seed, you were just waiting? Don't hold your breath, huh? Okay. Right. But my point is that it takes time. Transformation takes time. Day after day. You don't expect to be changed in one day. You just keep plugging away. You put that seed, and then you water it, and you water it. You give it some time. It makes roots. We're going to be talking about that. If you notice, I'm taking my time. You know, a master builder takes his time to build a house, to build it right. And so I don't feel in a rush to come up with all these new things to talk about. As pastor here at Grace Community Church, I feel compelled in my spirit to lay a foundation, especially on Wednesday nights for a while, of God's word. To where we as a church, we have a hunger for what is in Scripture. That we would build his house with his word. Jesus said, whoever takes my words and builds his life with it, it's like building a house on a sure foundation. And when the winds come, and we know that winds are coming, the winds are here, but I know that this house is going to stand because God is building it with his word. But these things take time, day after day. This isn't microwave transformation. This isn't American Christianity, if you will, where, you know, you go to Burger King, you have it your way right away. You know, you stick that potato in the microwave and 6 minutes later, voila, dinner served. It doesn't work like that. You've got to give God and his word some time. And his word works. His word works. You got to be committed to the process. Getting in the church. Being with God's people. Sitting under the anointed teachings of a minister of the Lord, spending time with the Lord yourself, meditating in His Word. You do these things, look back in a year, look back in 2 years, look back in 5 years. You won't even recognize yourself. When I describe who I used to be to people, they're looking at me like, oh, I can't see that. Neither can I. I mean, I can't even believe that old guy that I used to be. That dude was ugly. I mean, sin made me ugly. Isn't that good? There's no shortcuts. Just be faithful to the reading of God's word. I'll just end with this. Joshua chapter 1. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Amen.